Oh, hi. I was just watching the monitor. You know that funky little song y'all get to hear out there? We have to hear it too. So we have to suffer through that. We've requested Hotel California and Stairway to Heaven, but they won't do that. Trying to get some new music in there. By the way, who does anybody know who wrote that song? Does anybody care? We don't care either. Oh, welcome to gender class. And our Seacoat Ranch people are not there yet, but they will. They will probably scare us when we start. Okay, we've been looking at these four main archetypes that make up the human psyche. Four, there's jillions that make it up. But we've primarily looked at these four. We've been looking at warrior, caregiver, lover, and as archetypes of the feminine archetypal energy. Males and females have both, masculine, feminine energies. And today we're going to finish a little bit on lover, and then we're going to look at seeker, and then we're going to look at the contrasexual archetypes, energies within. As we're studying gender and looking at that. But there was this great article. Let's go up front and come on. Yes, okay. Here we go. Hog, he left the camera. I saw you, he just, isn't that funny? When I got up, he had walked away. This is actually an article in the Houston Chronicle about old-fashioned French. This is a woman who wrote a book called Hillary Clinton, Inside the Story, a woman named Judith Warner. And the upshot of it is she lived in France for 6 years. And she went over there married with no children, and she had two kids while she was over there. And this is just an interesting article about gender. There was a book I wanted to write during the nearly 6 years I spent in France called The Tyranny of Seduction. I was convinced French women were on the wrong track, obsessed with their looks, preoccupied with their men, mired in perpetual game of kittenish femininity. It seemed they were willing participants in a culture that made a fetish of sexual differences, with women's part of all difference being outdated ideas that sapped their brains and ultimately made them incompatible of equality. This was confirmed in large part by the French media during an era of aggressive chest beating about men being men and women being women, all irresistibly attracted to one another. That guaranteed a degree of social harmony that pundits said was utterly lacking in the United States, where a virulent strain of feminism had turned women into aspiring men, effectively ruining gender relations. We want to keep the freedom to be seduced and to seduce, wrote feminist philosopher and wife of the Prime Minister, Silvana Agacinski, in her 1998 book, Sexual Politics. Isn't that fun? Just the wife of the Prime Minister is just out there with this. There never will be a war of sexes in France. Agacinski and other European feminists felt that by embracing a public image of gender-neutral egalitarianism, American women had cut themselves off from the perks of being female, such as good maternity leave and even the small joys of life, like doors being held for them and a chance to be treated with gallantry. How many of y'all like the door opened by some guy? Ladies, do you like that? Is it nice? Kim, do you not like it? Or you don't care? Either way. How many get the door opened by a guy occasionally? Really? Wow, see? In other words, American women were living dogs' lives. While in Paris, I thought otherwise. While in Paris, I thought otherwise. Surely I discovered when I had my first baby there that life was with a child was easy. The social protections were fantastic, even for a foreigner. 5-day hospital stay, tax breaks for paying a nanny, wonderful part-time preschool starting at age 16 months, all underwritten by government funds. Some of my French friends had still better perks, 6 months paid maternity leave, government subsidies, and the right to work a four-day week. But as a Newsweek reporter specializing in women's issues, I saw the dark side of these special privileges, a workplace culture with pervasive sexual harassment. After all, if men were men and women were women, you couldn't stop the attraction between them and the sexual discrimination as employers seized upon the cost and constraints of the country's protective laws to avoid hiring women of childbearing age. How could it be otherwise? If women wore their sexuality like a banner, it was only natural that they would bring upon themselves all the reactions that their sexuality generates, age-old prejudices, intolerance, hostility. By playing the femininity card, French women had mired themselves in traditional sexism. As an American feminist, I was of the girls can do anything school, resting on the idea that not only was biology not destiny, it was largely irrelevant. I truly believed, as I gazed back at my country from France, that American women had secured a gender-free public space in which they could operate with dignity as people first and women second. It's always nervous when someone comes walking towards you when you're speaking. Scott, my director here, started walking toward me, so I've been kicked out of places before. Amy, Shauna?
Hi.
Hi, welcome to class today. It's nice of you to drop by.
We couldn't get the computer system thingy to work.
Ah, yes.
We've been here, though.
Oh, yeah, yeah, likely story. We, I just shared something with them that'll be a full 10% of your next test, but don't worry about it. You can pick it up later. Just kidding, just kidding. Okay, I'm reading an article. Have you been hearing it?
I've heard the last part of it.
Yeah, okay. Not very much of it.
Okay, they didn't sound very excited. This is an article written by a Newsweek reporter, a woman who went to France and lived for 6 years and have two kids. And when she was over there and noticed the perks of these women in France that seemed to be so much better than the women in America, although, so this is where I'm picking it up. As an American feminist, as I was a, I already read that. So when a French source suggested I get better interviews if my approach was less direct and more feminine, I felt a shiver of superiority. It's easy to be an expatriate, to idealize, it's easy for an expatriate to idealize your homeland, especially when your thoughts of home were supplied by CNN and the movies. My years in France coincided with Janet Reno and Hillary Rodham Clinton, Ruth Bader Ginsburg of G.I. Jane and kickboxing Ashley Judd and black belt Rene Russo as a slew of female action heroes looking fabulous as they ran around with walkie-talkies and guns. Do you see the warrior energy in women they're talking about? I'd leave the theater and see French women tugging on their companion's arm, pouting their way into the night, and I'd think, God bless America, at least we're doing something right. And then the plot thickens. I move back to America. We settled in Washington, D.C. I started casting about for work. I asked a woman who worked for a female politician if there were any kind of writing I could do on Capitol Hill. That's not for you, she said. That's for a young person without children. I made some interested noises about working for a magazine. You wouldn't want to do that, I was told. None of us have children. I'd moved to France as a childless 29-year-old, and I came back a mother of two. Boy, was it an eye-opener. If anything, American women were caught in sex roles more traditional than those I'd seen in France. Suddenly, the horizon seemed lower for myself and my peers, who really did seem to be leading dogs' lives. The stay-at-home moms were in an infernal treadmill, school and play dates, soccer and gymnastics, ballet and tutoring, volunteering, with do-gooder meetings running into the night, and topping it all off, a mental chorus. Did anyone realize how hard they were working? Did anyone realize they still had a brain? Did anyone appreciate the time they were giving? Did anyone care about what they had to say? This uber momming represented a selflessness that would have been considered downright neurotic in France. No woman with a family life, the thinking would have run. No woman who wanted to preserve her family life, which is, after all, was anchored around her husband, would be out doing children's activities all day, let alone all night. The working mothers I knew looked tired and harried, talking about in America, with a media-fed dirge of guilt adding to their stress. Were they doing the right things with their lives? Were their children being well taken care of? Should they be working less, differently, not at all? Particularly odd was how readily my American peers accepted their stress and their guilt as a natural consequence of motherhood. It didn't seem to dawn on anyone that there could be another way. I felt almost as if I were caught in a 1970s era discussion about women's lib, ignoring utterly the facts that the bad old-fashioned French so heartily embraced, that the vast majority of women do work, that work is actually good, and that it need not be unduly stressful or guilt-provoking. The French, where mothers are concerned, have wedded their society's beliefs in la différence, whatever that is, to a realistic, humane view of modern women's lives. We Americans, on the other hand, have wedded an abstract belief in equal opportunity to punitive notions of women's choice and women's compromises. So once children come into the picture, women retain the right to compete in the marketplace, but lose the right to have a decent quality of life. Perhaps that's why Joan Williams, author of Unbending Gender, has, like many other American feminists, turns her eyes to France. She is particularly interested in French legislation limiting the work week to 35 hours. American workaholic culture creates many of the ills befalling women, Williams says. The antidote is a massive top-down restructuring of the workplace so that it's better adapted to the rhythm of a woman's life. Rhythms of a woman's life. Two more paragraphs. A government-mandated restructuring is unlikely anytime soon, however. And at any rate, it isn't government directives that dictate behavior. If things are better for French women, it's due to an enduring social consensus that life should be more made livable based on who they are, not on an abstract moralistic notion of how they ought to be. The conviction, however, rests on another fundamental belief, and I think this is what really captured me. Sorely lacking in America, that our emphasis should not be on doing as much as we can, but on achieving a decent quality of life. Maybe quality of life, pure and simple, is what we as women ought to be fighting for these days, not just for ourselves, but for our men, for the men and for the children in our lives as well. What is that saying? It's saying there's so much warrior energy, seeker, ascending energy, get to the top, you can do it, swish, be all you can be. We have so much imbalance in that energy that where's the energy for caregiving and lover and enjoying life and smelling the flowers? And a point I've been trying to make through this whole class is the wound in Western civilization is too much patriarchy and masculine energy negatively that takes us away from soulfulness and love and relatedness and connectedness. Frequently as a therapist, I see women who are become attorneys and CPAs and they move into corporate America. And I often say, be careful that you hang on to the strength of your feminine soulfulness and stand up for those values, because the corporate world will take that all away from you, because its one goal is profit. But profit at the price of people is a huge price. Any comments on that? Do you kind of hear what she's saying? It's not so much fighting for women's rights or men's rights. It's fighting for a way of life that we all can grow and discover and enjoy, and not for an overbalanced. Any questions from the Cinco Ranch people?
No.
You find that interesting at all?
Yeah, we do.
Do what?
We do. We find it interesting.
You're just saying because I wanted you to say it. That's okay, though. whatever you want, Dr. Agin. Well, anyway, that's stuff in the paper. And that. Our book says and other books say, it's all about, you know, women. It's all about equality of rights and dealing the emergence of. Really, it's sort of the emergence of warrior and seeker energy in women that we've been seeing because it's, you know, lacked culturally for a century or more, much more than that, many centuries. We've seen an evolution, but we're also seeing an evolution toward lover and caregiver in men. And we'll look at some of that in a couple of days when we look at the men's movement and the women's movement a little bit. Okay, so what I wanted to do is talk a little bit about, finish talking about the lover archetype, because I had one more thing to say about that. Dr. Agin, you never have one more thing to say. You have many more things to say. And let me just say this, because I want to give you four little things on we talked about, just finish up this, we talked about lover archetype, which is about connection and attachment. To all of life. And then the other one was what? Passion. And passion is about aliveness, emotionality, being, having your whole person respond to life. And these archetypal energies, this is a lover is Eros. Energy connecting one to oneself, to others, to the whole world. It's nurturing. It's romantic love. It's spiritual compassion. It's lover energy. It's very powerful. In fact, I brought this, leave it right there. I brought this book here, which is Pygmalion, isn't it? This is actually by Moore and Gillette on accessing the lover in the male psyche. It's a fascinating book. The reason I want to talk about this just a little more is that many of us, you know, one of the ideas of speaking and teaching is knowing your audience. And many of us in psychology have a lot of lover and caregiver archetypal energy. If this was a class on sort of, a business class on statistics or computer work, you know, their lover archetype is pretty much in the basement of their psyche. Not necessarily, but you would find that people with lover and caregiver energy would show up in counseling classes, psychology classes, classes about the soul. And so I wanted to address this a little more. So Eros is the call from our soul to move away from disconnecting as a way of living to connecting. It pulls us out of shallowness and callous lives. It pulls us into depths. Eros, the lover, it deepens our lives. Our lives. And when your life gets deepened or touched, you have ecstasy. That looks misspelled, is it? Huh? ECS. Thank you. You have ecstasy, but what do you have with it?
Agony.
Yes. Very good. you listen to any of the love songs, I always talk about, you know, the crucible of love is the suffering. But if, you know, it takes so much risk to love, and who hasn't loved, whether you're loving an idea, a person, anyone or anything, you invest in it. The lover archetype is the part that will invest in life, but in a deep in our life, but we'll have ecstasy and agony around it. My point as a caregiver and a therapist is to help people find meaning in it, because you're going to suffer in life if you choose to be conscious. If you choose not to be conscious, you're still going to suffer. But our suffering can find meaning because it can transform us and make us a more whole person. Love comes as compassion and forgiveness and grace. Love calls us to a life of deep feeling, to make commitments, to trust a decision. It's not always inspiring, but there's a steadfastness for the betterment of one's life. There used to be a book called Love Is Not Just a Feeling. And anyone who's raised children would discover love is not just a feeling. It's being there and consistently providing for another person what they need. It's one of the great things to change egocentricity is really love a person for what's best for them. Because you'll have to not think about yourself so much. And when the person says, I need more space, love says, you can have your space. When love says, I need support, then you can give support. So to live by love is to accept all love as a gift, for we cannot make love happen, we can't make love stay. And not just relationships, but in everything. The things we have passion toward, the things that inspire us and turn us on, they sort of come as a gift. And they sort of have their own life about them. And when love captures us, we are no longer free to attend to our wishes, are we? It's nothing like a good, hearty relationship to change the direction of your plans. A lover, a child, a work, a complex journey begins of attachment. It could be anything. You could just fall in love with a concept or start pursue an interest. It could be a job, anything that just captures our imagination, and suddenly we become, as it were, victims of our passion, victims of eros. And a lot of people can make a lot of apparently stupid, ignorant decisions because eros has led them. They're not using logos. But then again, if you use logos your whole life and don't ever let eros in, you'll probably have a flat, dry, meaningless life. Oh, and you'll be in control, but you may not grow, you may not adventure. So the real question in relationships is that the lover leads us to is, how can I be with you and still be me? If you have a relationship that's all conflict and there's no connecting, it's probably transforming for both, but love often won't stay. If you have a relationship that's all placid, sweetness and nice and never any conflict, well, that's just a setup. So any relationship needs enough support and tension, to enough commonality and enough differences in order for lives to be transformed. Got to have some spark there. Warmth of the spark, and as it were, the shocking transformation that spark happens. Because if all you do is look at yourself and someone else and just see yourself reflected, neither one will change. So that the differences can, what the woman's saying in France, that they celebrate the differences, masculine, feminine, male and female, the energy it brings. So what happens is, we looked at the, in the shadow side of love, which we talked about, we can end up getting addicted. And in our shadow, we can get addicted and get stuck. And remember last class I talked about that codependency? And I gave you a kind of an analogy of what that is. And I have to say this is real important for therapists, because any caregiver, anyone who has a lot of lover archetypal energy connecting to life, we tend to get in relationships too long and stay there. And so, but there's no shame in that, because most people get out of relationships too quickly and don't stay in there long enough for things to be worked through. And often what's called is, oh, you're just codependent, you're attached, you're a real sicko, you can't let go. It's often that lover energy that's saying, wait, there's gold in their hills, and I'm willing to dig around a while to find them. And that's the lover energy. But the far side of that is the shadow of that is you get caught in a quagmire. And in this culture where we value independence and we see dependency as some form of weakness, the fact is we need both dependency and independence. In fact, we need what's called interdependence. But the lover archetype can often fall into a quagmire because the tendency is to unite and stay close. The warrior energy, of course, is I'm out of here. Go fight another battle. And remember, our culture, patriarchal, you're captain of your own ship, master of your own fate. Come on, just make the choices, move on. And often I see a lot of couples in my office as a therapist. You know, I often say, well, you know, they come in with marital problems, and I say, well, you know, maybe you need a divorce. I don't know, but there's a lot of things to divorce before you divorce each other. Like divorce your parents. That's usually the biggest thing, because there's still a loyalty to pleasing parents, whether they're dead or alive. Divorce concepts and ideas and attitudes that you've outgrown. Divorce images of that person you're with, what you imagine them to be and do and how to act, and suddenly discover they're not your image, they actually are who they are. So you have to be willing to divorce old images and embrace that person for who they are. There's philosophies and theologies and a lot of things that need to divorce. That we have to leave and abandon and move on to another place. And I often say, you know, if you're willing to look at this for a while, you can decide down the road in a few months whether you want to stay together or split up. But if you split up too quickly, sometimes you don't stay in there and struggle with it enough to grow and mature. And you may be throwing the baby out with the bathwater because you're not willing to honor that connectedness for a bit. So people and therapists, anyone with a lover and caregiver archetype often can get stuck. And so there can be too much commitment, as it were, too much invested commitment, or too much passionate investment. And that's the extreme, is what I'm trying to get at, that a lover often falls into. So there are four processes that help us here. And this is four processes that Carol Pearson talks about. That help free the shadow lover or that codependent person. I mean, we're all codependent. My God, it's just human. But so I'm not saying that's a codependent person and others are not. But I think this is interesting to look at. And one of the things that happens is one process is the destroyer. We hadn't talked about it, but it's in that list I gave you. The destroyer enters to stop the attachment. Has anybody ever had the destroyer show up? Has anybody ever had their heart broken through a relationship that started so well and seemed so close? Can't we all just get along, this unity? And the destroyer comes in and somehow it ends. What's the number one experience around that? Emotional experience is what? Pain. You ever felt pain and the destroyer shows up? Have you ever been in a, you know, I heard the other day that, I may have said this, 65% of the marriages in towns of 350,000 or more will end in divorce. Well, if you're a kid and your parents are together and they divorce, the destroyer enters and that thing's destroyed and the kid experiences tremendous pain. The three most difficult things a child can experience growing up are the split up of parents, changing schools, and moving home from their house. And some kids go through that once or twice before they're 10 or 12. Change schools, parents split up, and they change where they live. So the destroyer shows up. And this is one of the things that happens, and it's very painful. But we survive. In fact, often we find we have greater strength within than we thought. A place to stand. It's very painful. And when those of us who don't realize that the destroyer archetype is one of the arrows in our quiver, and we're sort of stuck in lover, caregiving archetype, we can always work this out. Often when the destroyer comes around, we go, where in the world did that come from? And we don't realize that part of life is letting go, and things have to end so something new can begin. I mean, I personally hate that part of life, because with a strong lover archetype, I tend to invest a lot. And so when the destroyer shows up, that's the purpose of that archetype, is to say it's time to move to a new place. You were talking about that, Kim, weren't you, about knowing something about the destroyer? Have most of y'all in here had experience with the destroyer archetype? Have you lost things, relationships, people, experiences? And that isn't meant to be a mean thing. That's just reality. This destroyer part shows up. The second thing is that that helps in this process to free the shadow lover is that we discover love is plentiful, not scarce. And that is simply that what we discover is that love has many, many sources. And we discover is that the more we love, the more we get love back. So when we get stuck in that shadow lover, we discover the process that helps us is the destroyer enters, and we go, and for many of us, it's like, how can this be? Second thing we discover is that love is plentiful, and it's not scarce. When we say, well, this one job is the only thing that's going to give me meaning in life, and we discover, no, there's other things we can love, other thing, or this one relationship, or this this child growing up and leaving home, going off to school. I see so much work as a therapist helping parents learn to detach from their teenagers. It seems like I'm always saying, remember the theme of adolescence is detachment from mother, so that a child, former child, young adult begins to mother himself or herself. And the key is, as a parent, is not to take it personally. But I'm telling you, if you have caregiver and lover archetypal energy, the only way you can take it is personally, because there's an overinvestment of connectedness. It feels very personal, but your logic will tell you it's not. And you know, I told a mother the other day, I said, why don't you stop mothering this 17-year-old and be a middle-aged woman and be a mother and stop mothering? Because this 17-year-old young man doesn't need to be mothered. He needs care and support and friendship, but he needs to be treated like he can make these decisions on his own, make his own choices in life. And this is a mom who has tremendous lover, caregiver energy. And it's just like she doesn't have a warrior out there. Her destroyer's not out there. She's just got a couple of archetypes working when there's the vastness of archetype. And what we're looking at is the idea of becoming a whole person is integrating more of your archetypes. I told her this, and again, this is a generalization. I said, as a general rule, fathers make better parents after the first 10 years. Fathering is more appropriate than mothering. First 10 years, mothering. Second year is fathering. Men and women can both do that. And I made some suggestions like, okay, here's some deals. No unsolicited advice. You can't give advice to your 17-year-old son unless he asks for it. And you can say, would you like some advice? I'd like to give you some advice. Do you want it? And if he says, nope, then you can't give it. See? And that's hard for someone with lover, caregiver energy, because it's hard to let go of that. But what ends up happening if you just keep doing that? I'm waiting for a response. Well, what happens if the, say, a mother just keeps on holding on and mothering those emerging young adults? Do what? Push the button. Well, you can go on TV, man.
She smothers.
Yeah, she smothers. And what does that do to the relationship? Yeah.
The kid wants to run away.
Yeah, right. Any healthy person would say, I'm not putting up with that. Because what's happening is the destroyer's entered and said, this is no longer a mother-child relationship. It's a mother and former child. It's two adults emerging. As an older adult and a younger adult, in all healthy families disintegrate in an orderly fashion. Do you hear the destroyer there? Mother stop mothering, father, parents stop, mother stop mothering, father stop fathering. Children stop looking for validation, permission, sustenance from their parents and normally go find it in another relationship. And some of the best friends in life can be your former relatives. But if we hang on to that, what happened is often the destroyer has to come in and pull it apart and people get hurt and wounded, and it may be decades before people are able to get back together and grow up and mature. Two more things let me throw out here. So when we get stuck in this process, the destroyer enters to stop the attachment. The second is we discover that love is plentiful, and actually there, and it can be Mother Nature, it can be all around life. The next thing is the healthy warrior may emerge. To set boundaries. Of self-care. Many lover types are deficient in warrior energy. And when the warrior develops, we practice this thing called tough love. And this is for the good of all. And isn't it amazing? Sometimes we have to go like through this codependent, smothering, difficult deal in order for the warrior to come forth. Let me give you an example of this. Say in a business relationship, it could be say a woman who's naturally closer, or this one particular woman, to the feminine, cooperative, receptive, living in process, relating, serving, nurturing. She's willing to be a team player, and this goes on and on. She could be working for a man or another woman or in a system, and all of a sudden she discovers, you know, other people are getting raises and she's not. Or she discovers there's a sexism going on or a nepotism going on or something that's highly unfair. Well, if all she's lived out of is her caregiver, lover, you know, archetypal energy in her employment, and she has her warrior energy has never happened, then she's going to stay a victim, isn't she? Because she doesn't know how to pull out that arrow from her quiver to say, wait a minute, I'm not going to be a chump here. I have rights, and I have an opinion, and I want to be. I feel like I'm being mistreated. I see someone caught in a negative lover archetype would never say that because they'd be afraid of abandonment. So what happens is often in that setting, the healthy warrior begins to emerge. And usually it shocks everyone because they because see what we've done is we made a stereotype of that archetype. Oh, no, you're a supportive person. You just go along to get along, to go along, whatever it is, so there's no conflict. No, that's your role, is just to be a caregiver and a lover, and you're not supposed to have opinions, ideas, thoughts, and feelings, and you're developing an attitude. And see, actually what's happened, this person has kept their warrior energy buried for decades. and then it comes up. That's why it's important to begin even now to set some boundaries, to say what you want, you know, practice your warrior energy. And for those of us who have lover and caregiver energies, it's important to know that the warrior energy will need to get developed. Where if we don't have it developed, how do we go find it in relationships? Don't we go marry it? Or don't we go find a job with someone who's got warrior energy? And so we say, I'll be the caregiver and you take the risk. Anyway, so you see the positive thing that comes out of getting stuck is, you know, we find the destroyer. We actually, you know, and this is very painful. We have the slate clean, so something new begins. We discover that love was not just there, but it's other places. We also discover that there's a warrior within us that's been wanting to emerge for years. And of course, if you grow up in a home where you have warrior mother, father, masculine energy negatively working, then a person may stay down for generations. And the fourth thing, is we learn to love ourselves. See, we learn to love ourselves, which means, we learn that we always have ourselves. So we are always loved. That's often very difficult for people, particularly when we have energy that connects and relates to other people. A lot of people in psychology, a lot of people in nursing and healthcare professions. We learn everybody else, we just don't know how to love ourselves. But often this experience, we'll discover that we can learn to love ourselves in some new ways. It's painful, it's often difficult, but it seems to be a process that helps us transform. A handout I gave you, I think y'all probably have. Did I give you this? I did. I don't think I read it though, did I? After a while. Y'all have it out there in Cinco Land?
Yes.
Let me just read it. This kind of goes with this. Veronica Schostal, whoever that written by. And you can tell she must have gone through some difficult experiences. After a while, you learn the subtle difference between holding a hand and chaining a soul. Maybe changing a soul. I think it's chaining. And you learn that love doesn't mean leaning and company doesn't mean security. And you begin to learn that kisses aren't contracts and presents aren't promises. And you begin to accept your defeats with your head up and your eyes open and with the grace of an adult, not the grief of a child. And you learn to build all your roads on tomorrow because tomorrow's ground is too uncertain for plans. And after a while, you learn that even sunshine burns if you get too much of it. So plant your own garden. Decorate your own soul. Instead of waiting for someone to bring you flowers. And you learn that you really can endure and that you really are strong and you really do have worth. Isn't that pretty darn good? And then I threw something else in there in your handout. About 10 steps for people who love too much. Did you see that? And again, this is, I'm not really going to read it here because we have some other stuff to do, but it's kind of something fun to look at and think about, and particularly for those of us, I'm kind of addressing the caregiver, lover, archetypal energy that many people in the caring professions have. Again, that's why doing your own work is essential for helping other people. For if you don't do your work, then you'll be a vampire on others. Okay, let's finish our last archetype so we can move on, and that's the seeker. And the seeker is the desire to become. It's actually to individuate. It's the seeker is Wunderlust, isn't it? The seeker archetype yearns for more. It's the part of us that yearns for more. Seeks the grail. Wants wisdom. And wants to cross new frontiers. The seeker is the part of us that wants to ascend. To respond to a call, to the call. It's a woman 50 years ago that says, I want to be a physician in America, when maybe it wasn't popular for women to be physicians. I want to do that. I have this call, this urge, the desire, and I'm going to do that. I want to become CEO. I want to become president. I want to become a general. And generally we see the masculine energy is around seeking, taking risk, moving ahead. The seeker actually aids in ego development. The seeker searches for a better way of life. A better way. A better future. It's the impulse upwards. That's seeker energy. You with me? I mean, in many ways, you wouldn't be getting a college degree if you didn't have some seeker energy. Go sign up for the course, take the course, take the notes, study, read the material, dialogue, give it back. JFK with the New Frontier, Martin Luther King says, I have a dream. See, and often what happens is in our unconscious, you know, when the, I have to draw this today, or you wouldn't think you were in my class. the seeker is that true self will emerge all the time. And if the world says, oh yeah, we want you like you are, good. If the world says, nope, women can't do that, men can't do that, then what happens is the seeker gets thwarted. And in our culture, to a large degree, I mean, this is what we're seeing is that this, you know, we found more opportunities for men. We're finding these things change, have been changing. So it's a call to a new freedom, new opportunity, a higher awareness. Let me just read some of this. It's a call for wholeness and growth, for becoming your true self. It's the longing, and the seeker must cross some thresholds and explore new lands, new ideas, new experiences, learn about the world and my place in it. It's the seeker, it's a time to learn, risk, study, and experiment. One thing I find often with midlife women who've been primary mother caregivers and stay-at-home moms and stuff, and then they hit midlife and suddenly, you know, they move into the world of work and they sort of feel an entitlement because they're older and have experience, that they don't have to risk and learn by experiment, and that they don't have to study and go through these things that a seeker does, that, you know, y'all just find the job, the career you want, and just do it. But anyone knows, starting out with anything is we sort of learn by doing, and there's a lot to learn. Even parenting itself is you have a lot of seeker energy. Late adolescence or early adulthood or midlife, often the seeker comes pushing in, and many people say, you know, that's not what I want to do with my life. What I really want to study is X. When that happens, the seeker's emerged, and. It's the call to function at a higher level. It's to follow one's call to adventure and to become. I mean, what was her name? Helen Keller said, life is an adventure. It's nothing at all. And adventure, advent means what? A beginning. And the seeker within us is always having new beginnings, opening, new beginnings, new beginnings. Not in an obsessive way, but in a way of letting life continue to unfold. I hope my seeker energy is working in my life the last day I'm on this earth. I hope I'm still seeking and yearning and looking and inquisitive and discovering and integrating new parts of my herbness that weren't there. There's just so much of my life that is meant to come forth for all of us. See, and that seeker energy often has been, we've put that in the hands of the, it seems to be that's been the, we call it masculine archetypal energy, but it seems we've stereotyped that into male. Males can seek and try, but women, you just need to stay and keep your place. See, the seeker is the call to embrace a struggle. To be tested. William, y'all know anything about this in the Army? That's what it's all about. Here it is. It's to face the dragon. It's to test our courage. I mean, almost everybody I've seen in an initial counseling session, it seems like I always say, well, congratulations. It takes a lot of courage to come in here, take the time and trouble and money to come in and talk to someone about your life and its vital importance. What courage to make that step. See, because the ego is very humiliated at one level. Of course, the soul is relieved because now you're seeking and wanting, you know, it's like anything you're saying. I can't do this alone. Well, hello, nobody can. But the ego is often feels shame and crippled and wounded, like we should know better. How can we know better? How can you learn about life if you don't have teachers? And the good therapist is a teacher, help you learn about yourself. So it's facing these fears, facing these dragons. In fact, I have this quote I wanted to read. I read this in my other class, but it's really good. Did I read about waste places in here? About the desert? So this is seeker energy. This is a great poem. I used to have this memorized, but I don't now. Let me just read it. It's called In Waste Places by James Stevens. It's a little poem. It says, as a naked man I go through the desert, sore afraid, holding high my head, although I'm as frightened as a maid. The lion crouches there. I saw in barren rocks his amber eyes. He parched the cactus with his paws and stares at me as I go by. He would pat upon my trace if he thought I was afraid, if he knew my hardy face veils the terror of a knave. He rises in the nighttime, he stretches forth, he snuffs the air, he roars, he leaps along the sand, he creeps, he watches everywhere. His burning eyes, his eyes of bale, through the darkness I can see. He lashes fiercely with his tail, and makes again to spring at me. I am the lion and his lair. I am the fear that frightens me. I am the desert of despair and the night of agony. Night or day, whate'er befall, I must walk this desert land until I dare my fear and call the lion out to lick my hand. Those last two lines. I am the lion. I am the lair. I am the fear that frightens me. I am the desert of despair and the night of agony. Night or day, whate'er befall. You hear the seeker? The courage? I must walk this desert land until I dare my fear and call the lion out to lick my hand. Can I live without mother's approval? Can I live without father's support? Can I live without this relationship? Can I live with this relationship? Can I dare to pursue my own interests? Can I dare to trust my inner world? I mean, the fear we face is stuff inside of us. It's not these people. It's finding the courage to dare our fear and call the lion out to lick our hand. Isn't that just, God, that just gives me goosebumps every time I read this thing. Because that's the courage of the seeker. To do that. So any time your seeker energy comes forth, you'll find tremendous courage that'll come to do that. And there are a lot of very noble, courageous men and women pushing ahead. We look at the women's movement and these women who, you know, it took them 80 years when they started to get women the right to vote. 80 years. You know, to finally achieve that. And the civil rights movement. I mean, a lot of these things, you know, they're still going on. And it's the seeker that keeps daring to take the risk within. Okay, so the seeker archetype. And then let me talk about the goal of the seeker is to search for a better way. Or a search for the true self. Or for the true calling. I'm telling you, the seeker is going to keep nipping at our feet our whole life. And courageous is the woman who says, there's risk involved. I got to take these risks. You know, life will meet me there. And for the man to do that. But traditionally, it seems like men are warriors and seekers. Traditionally, we stereotype these things when in fact we all have all of these stereotyped caregiver and lover to women, when in fact masculine and feminine energies are embraced by all of us. And then what the task? I'm giving you goal, task, and gift, right? The task is to be open to a deeper truth. Deeper or higher truth. I mean, there's one level, this is it. What we got is what it is. But at another level, it's never it, because there's always more to get at. And the seeker energy is that which pushes us forth. And the gift is autonomy and ambition. A.M., sorry. M. I was talking to someone yesterday. I guess she's about 41 or something, and conflicts with her teenage daughter and all this. And, I was talking that in my classes at the University of Houston, probably 10 to 15% of them are people in midlife who've gone back to school. I mean, I teach daytime classes. And I have so much admiration for her because I know that, like John, I know y'all are paying tremendous price for that.
I can't hear you.
Oh, you can't? You want me to speak up? Can you hear me now? Hear me now?
Can't hear you at all.
Oh, have we turned off? Scott, have we turned off the, did we shut them out? Am I on the air now or not? Huh? I take that as a no.
Oh.
What are we?
I can read your lips.
Did y'all turn off the volume or something? We trying to get rid of those Cinco people? Can you hear us now?
We can't hear you.
Okay.
I'll get the security guard. He's making fun of us.
We love live TV. Well, you want me to just keep talking? Yeah, we're on the film. Y'all have to watch this on the film, you guys. Tough darts. No, something'll happen. It'll work. But the point is it takes a lot of seeker energy in midlife, having invested in certain things, committed to certain things, suddenly to awaken and go in another direction. But I'm telling you, if you don't do it, you're psychosomatically, you and relationally, you'll pay a huge price. Because the obsessive parents who are trying to get their kids to get a good education that they didn't go get are often asking their children to complete things they didn't do. The midlife parent who's encouraging their kids to get an education and who themselves are working on their own education, even if it's one course a semester, are doing the most important thing in parenting, which is modeling. See? And often that seeker energy is what pushes people out here, particularly in midlife. I mean, it does in our...
I think that's why he's making this thing.
they went and got the police. The security guy, that's who you need to help you. Yeah, he'll help a lot. Hey, they're still not picking up our audio. But we're going to just keep going. Now we have the police officer sitting there in front. Can y'all see him there? Yes, sir, officer. Like I was saying, be sure and support your police officer association. Okay, so the shadow of the seeker is?
We need closed captioning.
There you go.
The shadow of the seeker is? Can you read my lips? Oh, I'm on notes. Oh. Wait. Can you?
Yes, it's George Osinko Ranch. We lost a sound over here on the program.
Try.
Just kidding.
Just we've kidding. Tried that. There was no sound.
Okay. The shadow of the seeker, isn't this fun, is, there's actually two sides of it. One is excessive ambition. Excessive ambition, which is perfect.
Ambition. Okay.
Is perfectionism. That's sort of that obsessive need to be independent. It keeps us isolated and alone. You know, it's ruthless. Pride.
Yeah.
What was that? Hubris. What did he say?
No,
okay. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Oh, he's calling the TV.
My TV's at full volume on them and my controller.
That's cool. Okay. So part of that is perfectionism, pride, and excessive ambition is the inability to commit. Wait, the second part of it is the inability to commit or the aimless. This is the second part. Aimless wanderer. That would be the other shadow side. Is the push, the excessive ambition, push for perfectionism, ruthless pride, hubris. And then the other shadow side is the aimless wanderer.
Yeah.
The seeker that says, I want what I want when I want it, and I'm never going to stop until I get it. See, that's shadow stuff.
Right.
It's like, give me a break. And the person who just is always seeking and searching, wanderlust, you know, there's no place to lay your head. You can always keep moving. A lot of people run from, you know, it's fearful to commit. Because to commit and be rooted and to stay put means you're going to let something happen inwardly and relationally. To stay at a job and a career, even when it goes through bad times, because you feel called to it. I know as a psychologist. Are we on the air now? Can y'all hear me? Okay.
Yeah, it was
important. Well, who is he? We hear his voice. So anyway, sometimes it's staying with something when it gets empty and it dries out and let it work itself through. But the negative seeker is just can't wait to move on because it's too difficult to stick around. So actually, the gift of the seeker is autonomy, ambition, and I want to put one more up here, and that is autonomy, ambition, and... spiritual transformation. trying to do this for them. Y'all guys see that? Oh. She can't read it? We got all these pens.
I don't know.
I know. And I've always wanted to do this. When you have a bad pen, just throw it. See, yeah. David Letterman. It's, okay, spiritual transformation is another aspect of the gift.
As a gift?
Yeah, yeah. Gift of seeker. Autonomy. Ambition. And...
Can you move that down a little bit? Okay, got it.
Okay, there it is. And you see why I would say that? Is when I say spiritual transformation, I'm not talking about, you know, where you go to worship. I'm talking about your soul. The transformation of your life will have to have the seeker energy. You got to knock. You got to seek. You got to ask. You got to look. You got to follow the dream you had two nights ago. You got to follow the holy hunt. You got to follow the thing that makes you angry, the thing that entices you. You got to follow the inner urgings, the promptings. Remember we talked about that? That third level of authority, traditional, rational, and then charismatic authority. A lot of seeker energy is following your inner way, inner path. Okay, any questions or comments on that? To get it, kind of? Okay, so what we're looking at then is, so what we're saying is, what we're saying in terms of looking at gender is that primarily we find that masculine energy seems to get stereotyped in warrior seeker. Feminine energy gets stereotyped in lover caregiver. That's not just stereotyped, because the studies would show that women tend to be closer to caregiver lover, being bearers of children and nurturing. And men tend to be more warriors, searching, hunter-gatherers. And we've looked at, you know, historically we have evidence for that. But the point is the first half of life, the goal of the first half, I'm going to write most of this since they can't hear it. The goal of the first half of life is to become your gender, as defined by your biology, culture, choice. You with me? And then the goal of the second half of life, and when does that begin? Huh? When does it begin? No, you're thinking Chronos and not Kairos. If you're 21 years old and both your parents get killed in a car wreck, believe me, you've started your second half of life. It has nothing to do with age. It has to do with... Oh. Okay. Amy and Shauna.
Yes, sir.
Get a job. Quit school.
Yeah, right.
Scott, our director, said he'd send you a tape.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Very. Are we finished with Seeker?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, but they could stay with us, yeah, but... I'm sure these people watching this on TV are going, this is really great. Okay. This guy's writing notes to this, but stay with us. We only have, how much? 5 minutes.
Okay, all right.
Okay, so here we go. So if the first half of life is to become your gender based on color, and I mean on culture, maybe color, biology, choice, everything, the idea is if you're, that would mean if you're born female, woman, become all that the culture defines for a woman to be. If you're male, become all that male, the culture defines for male. That's the first half of life agenda. And the first half of life is about... I don't want to do this. The first half of life is a psychological thing. It's not necessarily a biological thing, although there is a biological component. Having accomplished the task of the first half of life, the second part will come. Many of us in psychology are old souls. You know, we're thinking about things that many of our peers aren't thinking about. Do y'all ever find that deal? And see... And we're called weird, see, because we're really into more of the second half of life issues in the first half. Okay, so the goal of the second half of life is to become a whole person. Are you with me? Okay.
Okay.
Okay. And to do that, we must what? Integrate our contra-sexual What's that, y'all?
What is that?
What is that? What is contrasexual gender?
We have no clue. If you're asking us.
Is that? Good. See that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Like that paper you sent us, that handout kind of?
Yes.
I did that.
Cool. we only got a minute left. It's two. More. Psychologically, to be whole.
Okay.
Okay, bye. Oh, yeah, we're on the air, too. Oh, I guess there's this.
Bye.
Okay, we're done. weird.